Welcome in. People are trickling in. I'm very happy to see so many of you here. Looking forward to getting started in just a few minutes. In the meantime, we're listening to some Diana Ross. How's everyone doing this morning? Feel free to let me know in the chat. And yeah, ask everyone to keep themselves on mute just for the moment. We'll have plenty of time for interaction in just a bit. Hope everyone is doing well. All right, so I think we're gonna get started. Again, hello and welcome. Welcome to the live workshop that we're going to do today on power and decision making. This is just a taste of a full-length workshop that we normally do in the Shifting Power Accelerator, an online cohort-based course that helps you push for meaningful change in 8 weeks. I'm really happy to have you all here today. As you join us, please share in the chat your name, your location, and a favorite place you like to visit near your home. Emojis are welcome. And the favorite place near your home that you love to visit can be very simple. I'll share in just a bit what mine is. While you do that, I'll take a moment to introduce myself. I'm Maya Hasan, a Pakistani and American non-binary woman with light medium skin tone and dark hair. I'm wearing gold tone metal rimmed glasses and a black and white patterned dress. In case you're wondering why I describe myself, visual descriptions are a best practice for making meetings more inclusive for visually impaired people. So I'm modeling that practice for you. And as many of you already know, I am the facilitator of today's workshop on power and decision-making. I'm joining you from my home in San Juan, Puerto Rico, also known by the indigenous name of Borinquen. And I'm very excited to hopefully a lot of interaction and I'm sure a lot of rich discussion. So I've shared my name and my location, and now I'm going to share a place that I love to visit near me. And again, I'm going to keep it very simple. I recently started a daily walking habit in my neighborhood. Every day I try to take a walk in a different direction, but I usually find myself returning to the same place. I live near an art museum, actually in the arts district in San Juan, and there's a beautiful garden in the back that's open to the public. So it's an oasis from the sights and the sounds of the city, and it's just a special place that I'm grateful to have in my neighborhood. So would anyone else like to share? I'm seeing there's quite a lot of chatter. And I welcome you to put that in the chat, but would anyone like to raise their hand and share their favorite place out loud, maybe their name, location? Feel free to raise your hand because we have quite a few people here today. And if not, I will be reading a few. Welcome Amanda, joining from just outside Belgrade, who enjoys visiting cafes in the city to catch up and conspire. I love that word. With friends. Welcome Gloria Minha Minja. Apologies if I'm mispronouncing your name, from Tanzania. The supermarket close to my home. Oh, that's nice. That's very sweet. Natasha from Washington, D.C. Favorite place near me is Sligo Creek Trail. Oh, I don't know it, but looking forward to hearing more about it one day or maybe visiting. So thanks, everyone. We have a lot more people than I anticipated showing up to this workshop. Unfortunately, probably not a lot of time for everyone to speak up, but we'll have a bit more time during the breakout session today. I also want to take a moment to welcome and introduce Danny Ortiz, who is a new member of the Fearless Project, which is the hosting organization of the Shifting Power Accelerator. Danny will be acting as my behind the scenes co-facilitator to help share links to make sure we don't miss any questions. So let's get started. This is something that I like to share at the beginning of my workshops to make sure that we're all on the same page in terms of norms. Very importantly, and firstly, reflecting on power. This is something that we don't always think about when we show up at workshops, but power as we will soon know, is everywhere. It's really important to reflect on, should we be giving more space to others, or should we be taking up more space conversely? Power can even show up in ways of introversion and extroversion in terms of our personalities. So this is really important to think of, plus other social identities, which we'll talk a lot more about today. Being relational, this is important to help build a safe and brave space so that people can feel comfortable sharing. Being present, using body language whenever possible. I like to give thumbs up or ask if people understood me, or doing the okay sign, doing reactions. Zoom has many of these functions built in, so that's great. You can use the chat, you can use the reactions available. I love that. It helps me feel a little bit less lonely up here on stage. We have 84 people on the call, amazingly. So if you can stay muted for the most part so that we can avoid the sound interference, and raise your hand if you'd like to speak. I would love to give you the platform as well. Ask questions if you can in the Q&A box so they don't get lost. Tell us if you're away. This is a 60-minute, a one-hour workshop. We are not going to take a break because we have a lot of rich content, but if you need to step aside, that's totally fine. Let us know. Just say BRB in the chat, or use a little coffee cup reaction in Signal to let us know. We have enabled closed captioning and a transcript to make things accessible for everyone on the call today. So you can optionally turn that on or off. Similarly, I would actually love to see your faces. So if anyone out there is able to turn on their video, please turn on your video and let me see your lovely face. If you're not able to, that's fine too. I know there may be many reasons for that. We encourage you, but don't force you to do that. Okay, I'm seeing so many people turning on their faces. Hello, everyone. All right. Otherwise, an important note, this workshop is being recorded and it will be available within 24 to 48 hours. So please feel free to look out for that. Similarly, all of the workshops on the Shifting Power Accelerator are recorded. Breakouts are not recorded. So we'll have a breakout session today and you'll have some privacy there. What else? Does anyone else have any suggestions in terms of norms, meeting norms? Please feel free to drop them in the chat. This is really important, what you're going to learn today. How to identify power in terms of its formal and informal types. There are many frameworks out there to understand power. I'm going to keep it simple so that we can get to the meat, which I believe for this workshop today is going to be intersectionality. So that's going to play a very central role today. How to assess key decision points for equal or community-led partnerships. We're going to get into that. In addition to intersectionality, positionality, privilege, power, what do those mean? How do those look and how to reflect on those? Before we jump into the workshop itself, I want to share my backstory so you get to know me a bit better and why I started the Shifting Power Accelerator, why I'm offering this workshop. Here are just a few of the nonprofit organizations, grassroots, national, and international, that have trusted me in my 20 plus year career. There's a photo of me here with my Bangladeshi and Rohingya colleagues while we were carrying out research in the refugee camps outside Cox's Bazar just a few years ago. And it was during my time working for international NGOs and supporting civil society programs in Afghanistan, Central African Republic, South Sudan, Bangladesh, and Myanmar that I kept encountering the same disturbing dynamics. Within the INGOs, there were explicit but also implicit hierarchies. Some people, the ones with the preferred nationalities or educational backgrounds, just had more power than others. In particular, light-skinned Global North staff or partners were usually empowered to make all the decisions and determine the ways of working. In contrast, dark-skinned Global South staff were usually disempowered and resigned to follow their lead. And it didn't stop there. This top-down effect rippled through our work with our partners and the communities that we were supposedly serving. Please feel free to drop a yes in the chat if this resonates with your experience. Does this resonate with your experience? Ooh, a lot of yeses come in. So infuriating, isn't it? And for me, it was not only unjust in my eyes, but it also made no sense from an effectiveness standpoint. So it was wrong on level after level. And I went on a journey of applied learning. I immersed myself in social justice tradition, participatory approaches, design thinking, equity and inclusion. And I searched and searched for examples of shifting power initiatives happening across our sector. What I realized was for so many, resistance to change wasn't due to a lack of will. It was due to the lack of know-how. I didn't see an applied learning program out there that showed you how to do this and kept you accountable. So that's why I launched the Shifting Power Accelerator, so that emerging leaders like you and me could finally act on our values and learn the knowledge and skills to change our industry for the better. A last note on this slide, there is a really big QR code. If you scan it with your camera on your phone, it should take you to my LinkedIn profile. So if you aren't already, please connect with me there. It's the social media platform where I hang out most often. Now, today's workshop is on power and decision-making. It normally shows up in week 2 of the Shifting Power Accelerator. This is a very condensed version. Normally it's 2.5 hours long. This is a 60-minute workshop. So if you're interested in seeing the full version, of course, you can join me later on in the accelerator. Let's dig in. What's the number one reason an institution and community partnership fails? A partnership between a large institution, say an international institution, and a community partnership. What do you think it has to do with? Please put it in the chat. Just first thing that's coming to mind. What do you think is the reason? Or failure of partnership, lack of active listening, lack of trust and imbalance in decision-making, lack of communication, lack of valuing the expertise of communities, lack of community engagement. Yes, all of these and more. This is according to a report that I'm going to share in a bit. No strategic decision-making by community partners, okay? So what is a partnership if they're not involved in setting the tone of that partnership itself in making decisions? Here, according to this report by Ringo, 85% of civil society organizations based in the Global South said that their relationship with international NGOs in the Global North was not mutually beneficial, 85%. Here are some other responses. When asked, what kind of partnership do community leaders want? What are they actually looking for? What would be better? 55% of Global South CSOs, civil society organizations, preferred an equal partnership. 36% said that they preferred a bottom-up approach in which they were in charge. 9% said that they preferred a top-down approach, and 0% that they preferred a subcontractor approach. So of those of you who are part of the global aid and development industry, I know that there's a diversity of industries and sectors reflected in the makeup of the participants here. Is this surprising to you? And what about this is surprising? For me, it was surprising that 36% said that they preferred a bottom-up approach. Again, this is one report, and there are many out there, and these studies continue to be done. And you can look at the methodology here. I highly encourage you to look at the report called Fostering Equitable North-South Partnerships, Voices from the Global South by the Ringo Project, who is doing phenomenal work. I had a light bulb moment when I saw this. Okay, equal partnership. Maybe is just as good as a community-led partnership. Definitions here, they mean a lot. So this is how we're proceeding. Aid systems, because that's my industry, that's my background, aid and development. We have these dynamics of who's in charge, who's the dominant group. It's those organizations and institutions which are based globally and in the global north, and who are the groups that are underrepresented, that are effectively oppressed, is the local groups, the community groups, the groups and organizations based in the global south. There is a dynamic of hierarchy between donors and CSOs and so on. And similarly, this dynamic repeats itself at our national levels. And this is important to note, is that we don't always think about this. Even at a national level, within the relationships between government and grassroots groups, the relationships between policymakers and activists, the relationships between philanthropists and grantees, and so on, these top-down hierarchical dynamics exist in these areas as well. So what we're really trying to do when we talk about shifting power and what that is about is equalizing or moving in the direction of being more community-led. So that's what we're talking about. That's the approach, shifting the power from the existing status quo group to the more historically marginalized and historically oppressed group. All right, another chance for some interaction in chat. Free association. Tell me who you think of when I say powerful and try your best not to self-censor. I might read some responses out loud, but I won't say the names, okay, of who said them. Elon Musk, president of a country, white government, Jeff Bezos, donor, privilegios, privileged people, money, elephants in the room, donors and big corporates. Got it. Able-bodied folks. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. Who is powerful? This is who I thought of. My boss, when I'm doing consultancies, maybe the client that I'm working with, my managers, men in society, white people, the rich, the wealthy, donors, etc., right? That's who we think of when we think of who's powerful. But power shows up in different forms. It can look like formal power, or it can be more informal. So here's the difference. Formal power is more about an ability of someone or some group to impose their will on others. It's really based on authority. A lot of the time it'll show up in governance, in systems, in formal hierarchies. So in terms of who you report to, who is in charge, and that's made explicit. Then there's the more implicit, informal types of power. That is the ability for a person or for groups to deeply impact another's behaviors and beliefs. And it's based on persuasion. This shows up in culture and norms. And this is within our organizations, from organization to organization, from person to person. These show up in different forms. This is important to distinguish. Again, formal is about authority, giving orders, being rigid, enforcing things, and the ability to enforce things. And informal, on the other hand, about persuasion, asking questions, being flexible, having buy-in, and that way, commitment. And this is not a judgment on one is bad and one is good. Sometimes you have to use one over the other, depending on your circumstances, right? But the bottom line is power is still power. Right? So you can have power even when you think you don't have it. If you still possess the informal kind of power, the sway, I haven't said the word influence here on this slide or out loud yet, but influence is very much related and overlapping in terms of a type of power. But that's another workshop. We have a whole workshop on influence and organizational change. So who has power in our industry and in our sectors? What does power look like? And how does it show up? We can think of power in terms of money, funding, who's making decisions, governance, as well as who has voice and participation. So there's the formal power, which is more of the money, the concrete, tangible things that you see written on paper and out loud. And then you have who's participating, who's in the room. So here's a few questions you can ask. Who owns the funds? Who gives away the money? Who's making the decisions? Who's involved in that decision-making? Who's in charge? And then who's participating and who has influence on those decisions on who gets the money? Who is participating in the process? Who is being heard by those decision makers? This is just as important. So intersectionality is a really important component about power. And I'm surprised as to how many people in our industry are not very familiar with it. Here, in summary, intersectionality is a way of thinking about identity and its relationship to power. There was something that I noticed in some of the chat responses when I asked, who do you think of when I say powerful? A lot of the responses were mass entities like corporations, but it's really important to also think about the individual level. Where did power dynamics show up? Individual to individual, because those individuals then make up those organizations, right? So we're going to dig a little bit deeper into that, into what happens at the individual level and the interpersonal level. So intersectionality comes from sociology and interdisciplinary studies to explain this, that people's lives are shaped by their identities, relationships, and social factors, that these combine to create intersecting forms of privilege and oppression, depending on a person's context, importantly, and existing power structures. A brief trigger warning: on the next two slides, I'm going to be talking very generally about sexual assault in a state in India as a way to understand the concept of intersectionality in different contexts. So if this is a sensitive topic and you would like to excuse yourself, you're welcome to leave the session briefly and return in 2 to 3 minutes. All right, moving on to the next slide. So here's an example of sexual assault of young women in Manipur. Since last year, there's been an outbreak of violence in Manipur, a state in eastern India. A video of a sexual assault went viral last year in which Indian women's groups across the country responded and protested. They shut down Parliament for a few days. They demanded a stop to the recent outbreak of violence against women in Manipur. So, question for you, they demanded policing. Do you think policing is necessarily a long-term solution? What other factors could be at play here? Please share in the chat. Which social, economic, or historical structures or factors could be relevant to understanding the problem? I know I haven't shared much about the context here. You may not already be familiar with it, but that's okay. I'm curious to know, what other questions might you ask? What could be related to this phenomenon that's happening here, this tragic state of affairs in Manipur? Stigma, gender injustice, patriarchy, I see ethnicity, economic stagnation, war behaviors, existing laws, policies in India that protect people from sexual assault, age. Responding to this kind of discrimination and aggression demands different remedies and solutions beyond just policing, right? And we can understand that by understanding more about the intersections of gender, of ethnicity, social status, all of these things. So here in the case of Manipur, and the conflict that was occurring was between two ethnic groups and tribal affiliations. So one, the Meitei, which is a predominantly the majority group represented in Manipur state in that area, predominantly Hindu and the host community of that area, and clashes between the Kuki Chin, which were coming over as refugees from Myanmar since the coup. So there's multiple aspects and factors happening here beyond just gender, beyond just age. There's the issue of language, there's the issue of religion, there's the issue of, importantly, economic resources, documentation status. If you just looked at it from the lens of gender, you would be missing so much more in terms of trying to address the root causes. This is what intersectionality gives us, is that every person's lived experience and the group of every person is impacted, is compounded by multiple systems of oppression. So here in this case, we had ethnic discrimination, nationalism, sexism, misogyny, socioeconomic discrimination, xenophobia, refugee discrimination, religious discrimination. All of these are separate things and taken together create a really unique experience. And you have to be more creative to come up with solutions. What are the long-term solutions here? This is just one example. There are many more social identity categories that you can look at and that you should look at. And a lot of this is about mindset shifting so that you're able to do this. There's a list here on this slide, but I'll read a few more of them out. Disability, income, skin color, mental health, neurodiversity, body size. Some of these we don't even think about on a day-to-day basis. So it's important to do that. And the matching forms of oppression. So these are larger historical forces and structures that exist, the discrimination as attached to these categories. So you have casteism, you have colonialism, you have homophobia, colorism, beauty bias even. So if you haven't heard of some of these, I really encourage you to look them up and learn more about them. In sum, intersectionality recognizes that everyone has a unique lived experience, and that's according to their overlapping social identities and the systems of oppression that determine their proximity or their distance to power. You may have some of these identities, which then match to certain systems of oppression, and you may not have others. You may be closer to power in a certain context, in a certain situation, at a certain time. At other times, be further away from it, depending on the circumstance. So this is a really helpful dynamic. It's on my list of things to do to create one that's a little bit more easier to read. So apologies in advance for that. but this is called the Wheel of Power and Privilege. It's been around for a while, developed by Canadian social change educators. This one, as shared by Sylvia Duckworth, shows power at the center of these concentric circles. And this is in the context of Canada. So in the context of Uganda, in the context of Ukraine, these things could look very, very different. Context matters significantly. And over time, context also changes. In the center, we have you are slim, you own property, you're a cisgender man, you're heterosexual, able-bodied, etc. On the outside, the further you are away from the circle, the more marginalized you are. On the far end, they give the example of skin color at the very top in the orange. You're closer to power if you're white in Canada. You're furthest away from it if you are dark. You are in between if you're different shades. So that's also something that a lot of people don't think about, that this is a spectrum. It shouldn't be thought of as a binary. So I encourage you again to take a more in-depth look at that. I also encourage you to check out this intersectionality resource guide and toolkit offered by UN Women and UNPRPD, the Partnership on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. Dani has been sharing links to resources in the chat. She's just shared the link to this one as well in case you want to dive deeper. Now we're going to get into activity mode. And I'm going to share a little bit of myself as an example. So here I'm getting really vulnerable, and so I'm going to encourage you all to do that for yourselves as well. We're going to do an individual silent activity privately, and then we'll go to a breakout room to discuss. Here, this is called the Power Flower exercise. I believe some of you have seen this before. It's a very simple activity in which you can start to reflect on power, on privilege, on intersectionality, on positionality. Positionality is where you find yourself in different contexts and different situations. And intersectionality is about those overlapping identities and how they create a unique lived experience. Here, I'm going to share a few things from this image, which is taken from, again, Canadian social change educators. It's a popular activity. So this is a flower. We can talk about this a little bit more generally. We have leaves on the outside. We have the categories in black that are a concentric circle in a way. And then we have the petals on the inside. So the petals are what my identity is, what my status is. The leaves that are adjoining are what the dominant status is, or what the dominant identity is in the context in which I live or work or exist. Here, I'm using this example in the US context because I've lived in the US off and on. So in the US context, for citizenship, having US citizenship is being very privileged, is being powerful. You occupy a space in society in which you are dominant. Having dual citizenship in a way can be a privilege, but having Pakistani citizenship also disadvantages me in some situations. So this is a mixed one for me, depending on my situation and context. Say I was undocumented, this would be the most marginalized position or status, as opposed to say if I had European citizenship. So there's certain citizenships that will do better in certain contexts than others. Under the category of language, because I'm an English speaker, I have an advantage in society. I'm powerful, I'm dominant. Similarly, my education, I have a master's degree. I'm powerful, I'm dominant. When it comes to race and color, white people in general in society in the US are the dominant group, the most powerful group. I am a person of color, but I'm a light-skinned person of color. So I do occupy some advantages, but I'm also disadvantaged. Religion, Christian is the dominant religious group, and being Muslim, the instance of Islamophobia in the US, for example, I am disadvantaged. And then there's gender and disability. I'll talk about disability very briefly. I'm someone who is autistic. I was diagnosed autistic 2 years ago. And this means that my brain is wired differently from a neurotypical person, and it impacts the way I think, the way I process information, the way I interact with the world. While every autistic person is different, there are some things that we have in common that can give us certain advantages in society, like high pattern recognition, but also certain disadvantages, like the fact that not having a routine can make me very anxious if it changes. It's mixed, but in general, being disabled as someone who's autistic puts me at a disadvantage in society. So is this clear enough? Give me a thumbs up if it's fairly clear. Okay, wonderful. I'm sure once you start doing it, it'll all flow. So I'm going to give you 5 minutes and we're going to do this on your own. Find a pen and a piece of paper and do this individually. So I'm going to start the clock for 5 minutes and give you some time. I'll turn on a little bit of light music. Feel free to turn off your video if you prefer, and see you in five. Now we're going to go to breakout rooms. In the full session of this workshop, we have a lot more time to discuss, but we're going to go through it a bit rapidly just because of time. Here are a few questions. One is, in what context are you most privileged or are you more privileged? And in what context are you most marginalized? Perhaps you did this activity for where you live, but maybe you work in a different location or a different community or a different neighborhood. How does that look like when you change contexts? Diana mentioned a really good point in the chat, and thank you, Diana, for that, about shifting identities. Over time, your identities may change. For example, your age, the fact that everyone at some point in their life, if they live long enough, will be disabled. The older you get, the more limited mobility you have, you might become visually impaired and so on. And what does that look like for you? Perhaps you want to talk about that. Which characteristics cannot be changed about your identity and what can be changed? Are there certain categories that you didn't actively consider before? I shared these categories in the exercise, but there was a long list of other social categories. Are there some that you didn't consider before? How does intersectionality show up? And finally, in terms of applying this in your work, about your own power in relation to the communities that you work with, what does that look like and what does that say about how you might work together moving forward? I'm going to take a moment, open up breakout rooms. Please take a screenshot of this screen. I will also try to share the screen during the breakouts if that's possible. All right. Okay. See you in a bit. 10 minutes. Welcome back, everyone. All right. Who would like to share? Which brave souls would like to share with the group? Could I get one or two volunteers? Feel free to raise your hand. Natasha, lovely. Thank you so much for volunteering.
Sure. I had a really good discussion, Maya. This was really interesting, actually. And so thank you for sharing. But I had a really good chat with Sophia, actually. And we were talking a little bit about age and how at certain ages in your life, you might feel a lot less marginalized, say, because for instance, I'm an American of Sri Lankan origin, and there were times in my life where I felt, yes, a little bit marginalized as a younger person, but now in my middle age, I feel like I've come to a place where I don't feel marginalized. I feel pretty comfortable in my skin. So I'm just curious if that's something that has come up in this exercise. It wasn't really to share, but more to ask that question.
Does anyone have any reflections on that? On how your degree of marginalization may change as you age, as you grow, as you have different experiences? I can relate to that 100%. Natasha, you're a Sri Lankan American. I'm Pakistani American. So yeah, absolutely. Jenny.
Hi. Yes. I just want to agree with that and say, I think also not only age, but also gender. And I think that there's something about being a woman, right? And so at some point when we're younger, I think when we're really young, we have all this power. We feel like a lot stronger. And then all of a sudden we get into the middle school, high school, and we lose that power. And then as we get older, I feel like I'm in a place right now where I've gained some of it back and feel like I have that back. So I definitely agree with the age thing, but I wonder, I'm just curious if what other people think about that. Is it that, like, when do you like all of a sudden lose it and when do you get it back, or the sense of having it?
Susan.
I feel that as women age in the United States, that they can become more and more invisible. In the US, we have such a youth-focused culture. And so aging isn't always viewed as, this is a generalization, as wisdom and much and a lot to offer. And so I think that women can, as they age, fall into that perception by some other people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Elsie, I think you'll be the last one to share. Go ahead, Elsie.
I think with my experience here in the UK, it depends on what experience you've had that determine whether you still have that power. For me personally, I've had to fight for that power and that ownership, because one of the things I've discovered is being a Black woman and being well-educated doesn't really resonate well with a lot of people, especially being a Black disabled woman. I've had to fight my corner and prove myself quite a bit. And as I'm getting older as well, you're having to fight even more because you're Black and you're disabled and you're female. I think it's one of those things that you actually have to fight to continue to retain that power rather than actually having to lose it. I've had to fight for it to retain it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you for sharing. I'm sure that resonates with a lot of folks. All right, I know there's many more people who would like to share. Unfortunately, we're short on time, so we'll move on. But thank you all for sharing so candidly. Here, we're coming back to power dynamics and moving from top-down hierarchical dynamics to more equitable dynamics, and especially when we talk about partnerships. So a lot of what we've been discussing in this activity is at the individual level or at the interpersonal level, but you can also see how those dynamics play out in our workplaces, in our communities, in the context in which we work and in the communities that we serve, and what are our relationships to them, and so on. Just leaving you with this as well. The key point is that lived experience in the top-down hierarchical approaches, which is the norms of our industries, lived experience is not valued, not nearly as much as it should be or could be. And so moving towards more equitable partnerships, equitable relationships, lived experience is a form of expertise, and it should be valued as such. I said that we were going to talk about levels of community participation today. This is just a taste, and this is a graphic that's adapted from Partos's power awareness tool, which I highly recommend that you check out. It's a very valuable tool for assessing different levels of community participation, partner participation in your decision-making. So going from your community partner being excluded, which is level zero here, is not being really included at all, which sometimes happens in a subcontract approach, but it's generally level one or level two nowadays. Being informed, your global large institution or national institution is making all the decisions, and your partner is just being informed after the fact, or they're being consulted, they're being asked for input or for feedback. But an outline, a concept note, a strategy has already been created. And so it's really not equal partnership. So level three and level four is really one where we want to move into the direction of. And so co-deciding, what does that look like? When a community partner is leading, what does that look like? It's important to think about key decision points, because it could feel overwhelming to think about, where do I even begin, right? So when we think about key decision points, and this is an adapted graphic from the Partos Power Awareness tool about different stages in, say, a project life cycle, maybe a nonprofit or the philanthropic world, the research phase, exploring the needs, the gaps, the mapping, the planning, the program, the project design. At what level is your community partner actually participating in this? What are those levels of participation? Are they equals? Are they leading? Or are you just asking them consultations? Consultations is actually what we want to get away from as much as possible. And that is the default, and that is the norm. Similarly, at all of these different stages, at key decision points, whether it's selecting of the grantees, making adjustments and adaptations and how those should be made, measuring of the results, making decisions whether to scale up or scale down, there are many critical inflection points in a project or in the stage of a program that you can consider. I mentioned the Partos Power Awareness tool. I highly recommend it, and Danny will be sharing a link to this. If Diana is still in the audience, this is actually something that Diana Samarasan and Katie Love created, who are change makers in the participatory grant making space, a tool specifically for foundations about advancing participation. A very comprehensive, thorough tool. They looked at many other tools as they were creating it to have an understanding of key decision points in these various areas and how you can shift power and share decision making. So a moment of reflection for you. What is one way you can start using these frameworks at work? Another question, how will you keep learning and keep yourself accountable? So as you reflect on these questions, I'm going to take an opportunity to transition to the end of the workshop. And as I mentioned earlier, this was a 1-hour workshop, just a taste of the 2.5-hour workshop during week 2 of the Shifting Power Accelerator, an online cohort-based course to gain the skills and confidence you need to shift power to the communities that you serve. It's absolutely up to you, of course, but if you enjoyed this workshop, you might also be interested in joining the upcoming cohort, which starts exactly a week from today, Tuesday, February 6th. And what does it include? It's 35 hours of content over 8 weeks, 1 2.5-hour live workshop per week, 1 office hour with me, or a Q&A with special guest experts of the Shift the Power movement, and self-paced weekly assignment, and this is important, to be completed with a community accountability partner so that you are shifting power in real time, working on a change initiative. And by the end of the course, you'll have developed a concept note of a change initiative that you can start implementing at work. And I know that change doesn't happen overnight, so we have a built-in community of practice, including individual coaching, quarterly Zoom support calls, a WhatsApp group, and an email listserv, so I can continue supporting you and that you can continue benefiting from the support of your peers. If you're interested, please mark your calendars for these very important dates. Enrollment ends exactly 1 week from today on Monday, February 5th. Our first workshop will start the next day on Tuesday, February 6th. Finally, if you're ready to enroll in the course, that's amazing. And lucky for you, I do have a promo code, community10, that I hope will sweeten the deal. So that's for 10% off. If you're leaning towards joining, but something's holding you back, like cost or timing or something else, please reach out to me and I would be happy to jump on a call with you and together we can figure out whether it's a good fit. Now, if you decided that the course is not a good fit after all, for whatever reason, that's 100% fine. And I would still love to stay in touch. If you're willing, I would love to hear your feedback, especially on this workshop or about future workshops that I could offer. It's especially important to me that we're addressing pain points when it comes to shifting power in our industry. So if you have a suggestion or a question about how we can make it better, I would love to hear it. Finally, I've mentioned it before, but I'll mention it again because I can't say it enough. If you're passionate about shifting power, building equitable partnerships, and empowering local and community leaders and groups, I want to be around you. So this movement is only as strong as the ties that we build. So if we're not already connected on LinkedIn, where I tend to hang out the most on social media, please send me a message. Let's get connected. I want to support you in whatever way I can. So please feel free to reach out. Thank you again for joining this workshop. I hope it was useful. I know that I enjoyed myself and the rich insights. So have a wonderful day, afternoon or evening, wherever you're joining from. Take care. Bye-bye, everyone.